For about 15 to 20 seconds, can we remind that Joker and give him a spiritual headache?
And God is telling Jesus, get the hell out of Houston.
Can you look at somebody and say, I had to be stepped on, I had to be lied on, I had to be crushed, I wish I had some believers that would have church with me up in here. This...
Hey, So you already know that we give 10% of our income as our tithes and offerings so we can be of service to our community. So check this out. On April 15th, we're going to be on the corner of Bethany Church and 124, right outside the Goodwill, giving away meals for Resurrection. Okay, we're going to be teaming up with our very own Elder Tommy with Feed My People Corps. The address is going to be right here. And that's not it. We're going to be there probably around 3:30, 4 o'clock. And we're going to keep going until we run out of meals. But as soon as we run out of meals, we're going to go across the street and give away some gas. You definitely want to be a part of this. Please keep giving to Feed My People Corps, keep giving to Feed 500, giving your tithes and offerings so we can be a big service to our community. And on that day, April 15th, come join us. Help us give out meals. Help us give out gas. Help us be a hand and foot to our community. Let's do this. Address gonna be right here. Time gonna be right here. Everything will be right here. Let's go feed some people. That's what we doing for Resurrection.
What you doing?
The Easter food giveaway. So this is what's going to happen there. We're all set for that. There's just a couple of more food items we have to get. So if you have donations, just please continue to send those in. The more donations we get in, all of this money goes to getting food. So however much money we get in, we're going to continue to buy food until we run out of money. April 13th, we're going to pick up some eggs, potatoes, and onions. We're going to separate all that stuff and have it ready for the bags. We're going to assemble the bags beginning the evening of the 13th. Start putting that stuff together. On the 14th, I've got some chicken that I've ordered. So I'm going to go pick that up on the 14th and get that all situated. So we'll have that ready to hand out on the 15th. I'm looking to try to get some other meats, but right now, what we have right now is the chicken. April 15th, we're going to load the truck up. We'll have some signage out there. We'll have some people out there holding signs up to let people know that we're giving free food away. If you're still interested in volunteering, we'd love to have you. Just go to the website, feedmypeoplecorp.org, and just sign up for it. I think we have enough people to put the bags and stuff together, but we would love to get more people out there to distribute the food. So again, if you have any questions, just hit me up on my DM or email me or whatever way you want to get in touch with me. And let's make this happen. We are so close, and I can't wait till we start handing this food out. Hey, I love you guys, and I'll talk to you before the event. Take care. Bye now.
Yeah, so when I was a kid, they used to give us these bracelets that had WWJD on it, stands for What Would Jesus Do? And the function of it would be like anytime you're faced with some sort of difficult decision, you could look at this bracelet and then some way magically you just find out what the best decision is to make in that situation. And it spread like wildfire, of course. But as time went on, it began to become a joke. And it became a joke because everyone had the bracelet, but nobody really knew what Jesus would do. Going on Fresh Start. Welcome to Fresh Start, where we exist to revive, refresh, release, and to restore people back to God. It is our mission to make Jesus famous in your life. If this is your first time, second time, third time, your family, welcome. Hey, listen, we are starting our very brand new series in April called What Would Jesus Do? All right, so we're spending the whole month, especially gearing up into Resurrection Sunday, spending the whole month diving into the story of Jesus Christ. Some stories that we know, some stories that we don't know, things that we're familiar with, things that we're not familiar with, and we are determining the things that Jesus would do in these everyday situations and how sometimes that differ from the things that we might do. I'm stupid excited about it. I'm always excited about our new series every time we have one. This one,
no different. So let's go ahead. Let's get started. Go into John chapter 3. We're going to start at verse number 2, right? Or maybe I'm tripping. Is it John chapter 3? No, it's John chapter 2. John chapter 2, we're going to start at verse number 3. We're going to start at verse 3. I'm reading from the New King James Version. And it says, when they ran out of wine, the mother of Jesus said to him, they have no wine. Jesus said to her, woman, what does your concern have to do with me? My hour has not yet come. His mother said to his servants, whatever he says to you, do it. So the subject I'll be speaking from today is the push that I needed. Father God, we thank you. We thank you for your sovereignty. We thank you for your wisdom. We thank you for your love. We thank you for choosing your son to die for our sins and to resurrect him for the cleansing of those sins. We thank you for giving us the Holy Spirit. We thank you for giving us your love and your commitment to us every single day. We love you. We honor you. We praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The push that I needed. Yeah, so check this out. You ever been pushed to doing something like pushed or bullied? If you have, right, then you know that being pushed into doing something is like a double-edged sword. On one hand, it could very well be traumatizing, being pushed into doing something that you don't think that you're ready to do. Then on the other hand, if it works out, you'll be saying, man, that was the push that I needed. All right, so in this story, it's not even 2 weeks after Jesus just got finished with his 40-day fast, 40 days, 40 nights, and being tempted by the devil. So you know he tired, he hungry, and he just want to relax. And now he's traveling 3 days straight. He done got himself some disciples, he done got relaxed, and now he's been invited to this wedding. You know when you get invited to a wedding, you don't go to the wedding to work. Don't nobody go to a wedding to work unless you win the wedding, right? So they get to the wedding, they in there relaxing, Jesus, his disciples, his mama, ceremony is over, they are ready for the reception is on and going. And then they ran out of wine. Oh! Now, I don't know what kind of parties y'all ever been to, because this is a party. But the moment you run out of something to drink is the moment that either the party is over or somebody need to make a run to the store. Tell. So at this time, when they run out of wine, nobody really knows it except for the people who are working, the master of the feast, and they panic. But it's always somebody that's paying too much attention to everything. That's Jesus' mama, Mary. She recognizes that they are out of wine, right? They are out of wine. And she goes to Jesus, her son, the Messiah. She knows he's the Messiah. Everybody else don't know yet. And she says, hey, they out of wine. Now, you know when your mama tells you something, insinuating that she's asking you to do something, but she's not really asking you. She's just nudging you because you know what she's asking without asking. Says, hey, they ran out of wine. Right? And so Jesus is like, mom, come on. It's not even my time yet. What this got to do with me? His mama Mary don't even respond to him. She just goes straight to his disciples and says, hey, whatever he says to do, do it. Have you ever expressed your discomfort with doing something and the people around you just didn't care at all?
Yes.
It's like, I am uncomfortable. It is not my time. I'm not ready for this yet. And it feels like nobody's listening. That's what this is right now. Jesus is like, mom, this ain't got nothing to do with me. It ain't even my time yet. Like, please back up off me. She don't even say another word to Jesus. She goes straight to his disciples and be like, hey, well, forget all that stuff he's saying. Whatever he say to do, do it. This is how it turns into a double-edged sword. One, if you ain't ready, you ain't ready, right? And then two, don't nobody really know you like your mama know you, right? Because is it possible that at this point in time that Mary knows something that Jesus isn't paying attention to just yet? Every mama in the world got the same phrase, I know my child. Jesus is about 30 years old and Mary's still walking around with that same mentality, I know my child. Is she wrong? Is she right? Does it even matter? A lot of us get completely traumatized when we're pushed by somebody to do something that we don't feel like we're ready for yet. Something where we haven't really calculated, okay, that it's the right time to do it now. Something where we're like, okay, I'm supposed to do it at this time, not at this time. You trying to push the envelope. Jesus is internally screaming to his mama, I'm not ready. I really wonder if God ever really cares if we're ready for stuff or not. Like, really, is us being ready a prerequisite for the things that God wishes to do inside of us? Do we have to be ready for it? Or is that just a comfort we hold on to so that we could perform to the best of our ability? What would you do if you were in a public place? It's a wedding, it's a party, this is very, very public. You are in a public place with your mama, and she wants you to do something that you feel like you're not ready for. You know how it be when y'all at a party with y'all family, okay? Come on over here and do that dance that you showed me last week. Y'all know how it go. You know how it go. So what would you do if you're put in that situation? Some of us already been put in that situation before. Like, we pros at it by now. We got trauma bonds with it and everything. Like, we know what that is. What would you do? Something that you actually want to do, but you just feel like you're not prepared for it. You feel like you're not ready for it yet. You just need a few more times practicing this thing out in your mind before you actually go and do it, but they just push you into it anyway. What would you do? Would you run away? You catch an attitude? Would you do something spitefully so they leave you alone? That's on the list of a lot of stuff that I would do. But I'm serious, like, what would you do? Because, like, in this situation, Jesus is at a point where, okay, my mama just put a whole bunch of shine on me in front of my disciples. I'm supposed to be leading them. And now she pushing me to do something that I don't even know if I'm ready to do yet. What would you do? Yes, mamas can be nosy. They can be overbearing. They could be forceful. They could just be flat out annoying. But a lot of times our mothers know something that we just haven't paid attention to yet. But this had to be a really, really special party for not only Mary, Jesus' mother, but also the master of the feast to be so antsy about them running out of wine. This had to be something extremely special. I don't even know who got married, but they had to have been special. Either special to Mary, special to Jesus, special to the disciples, they special to somebody. Because when they ran out of wine, Mary immediately went into fix-it mode. So Jesus tells his disciples, hey, go fill those water pots up with water, up to the very, very top. These were water pots that were actually supposed to be used for purification. So these water pots were large enough that somebody could actually fit in the water pots. They are 40 gallons, 40 gallons of water, which equals out to 335 pounds. That's how much water that they're putting into these water pots. And Jesus tells them to fill 6 water pots up with water to the very brim. 40 gallons per water pot, right? 340 pounds of water, 40 gallons per water pot, 6 water pots. Boom, boom, more, 6. That's 240 gallons of wine, well, water, right? 240 gallons of water. I'm just trying to get us to see how many people is at this party. So, it's 240 gallons of water. Let's say everybody get a cup, right? Everybody gets a cup. If everybody gets a cup, that means it's about 1,920 people at this party. It's a lot of people. So not only is Jesus' mama pushing him in public, she pushing him in front of a high school football crowd. Newsflash, if you are afraid of embarrassment, you will stop yourself from doing so many things that you love to do. So the disciples are filling up the water pots, 40-gallon water pots, all six water pots, and Jesus tells them, okay, so you fill them up to the brim, now draw some out and take it to the master of the feast. So they take it to the master of the feast. He drinks this water, turned into wine, and he is flabbergasted. They've been at this party for a minute, and the custom is, when you're having a party, you give the good wine at the beginning of the party. And then when everybody nice and drunk, they lit, they can't feel their face, all that kind of stuff, then you give them the inferior wine. You know, you give them the Stella Rose and stuff like that. So, but what happened here is he drinks this wine. He's like, oh, you saved the best stuff for last. Could it be that the best stuff is saved for last because that's just how long it takes for us to be obedient? It's like we have what it takes. Like we already have this stuff, the good stuff already inside of us. And for some reason, we don't see what everybody else sees. I feel like Jesus didn't exactly see what Mary saw in him at that moment. But it took her pushing him out to a place where he was uncomfortable, to a place that he felt like he wasn't ready for, just to see that the best stuff was saved last. What would you do if you knew you had the best stuff inside of you every time you did something? What if you knew that you had the power for everything that comes out of your mouth to come true? What if you knew that you had all that power inside of you that you weren't even using yet? Jesus just gave these 2,000 and some people the best wine that they have ever had during this great celebration of a great union. And now he could sit back and be like, man, that was the push that I needed. Now look, I ain't got no answers for y'all. I got two questions though. Just two questions that's like really, really gonna help us getting that push that we need. Let's get started. Question number one, when am I ready? When am I ready? This is a loaded question because everybody's answer is going to be different according to their expectations of themselves, right? And so, like, to be ready means that you are prepared for immediate use, right? So to be ready means you're good to go right now, like, at this very moment. And everybody isn't exactly comfortable with that. As people who tend to be control freaks, we want to be the determining factor on when we decide that we are ready. And as much as I know everybody would love to agree with that, that isn't usually how everything works. Because how do you know if you are prepared for immediate use of something that you've never done before? How do you know if you're prepared for immediate use of something that has never been done? How do you know that you are prepared for immediate use of something that you have never experienced before? The things that God has for you to do and to be, we're not always going to exactly be ready for according to our standards of being ready. You know, for us, we got to have all our ducks in a row. We got to have plan A, B, C, and D. We got to make sure that everything is going according to that plan. And then that's when we're going to be ready. And I don't want to burst anybody's bubble too hard with this, but that's not how God works. God doesn't wait until you're ready to move on the things he has for your life. God moves on the thing he has for your life, and then you got to get ready on the way. It's every single story in the Bible. Bro, Moses was not ready, okay, to let his people go. Joshua wasn't ready for Moses to be gone. David wasn't ready to be king. Nobody was actually ready to be king. David, Solomon, Saul, any of them. So why would it be any different with you? Why would it be any different with Jesus? I have figured out that a lot of us use this not ready, and we make it sound real, real deep too. We'd be like, it's not my time yet. I haven't fully prepared for what comes with this. We know how to spruce it up real good, but we will use not being ready because we're afraid that we don't know what to do once we get there. We're afraid that we might mess it up. We're afraid that we might embarrass ourselves. We're afraid that we might let the people who count on us down. This goes beyond being ready. Now it comes to being willing. Oh, my wife said that. Jesus may not have been ready to turn that water into wine, but he was willing. And here's how willing he was, right? Mary, his mama, did not say nothing about him turning water into wine. All she did was say, hey, they ran out of wine. It is very, very possible that this idea of turning water into wine was already on Jesus' mind when he got there. You know how like we mentally, like we play out how things should, like how things are gonna go, how we would do in certain situations, and like we'll creatively like make these things happen in our minds, but we won't actually do it until we're pushed in that arena to do it, right? So this is what Jesus is doing. Like Jesus was ready and didn't know he was ready, because his standard of being ready is God. Like, don't let that, let's not get it twisted. Jesus is 100% God, but Jesus is also 100% man. So his standard, bro, don't nobody got standards like Jesus. Nobody. But Jesus is so intuitive and so creative and willing that he does something that no one has ever done before and that no one has ever done since. So when are you ready? When you decide that you are willing to go after it, when you decide that you are willing to make this thing work, when you are decided, I'm doing this, that's when you're ready. Question number two, when we out. Listen, I'm just going to let Jesus say whatever he got to say. We're going to keep it going. Question number two. Who is my miracle for? Who is my miracle for? We all know that a miracle is something happening in the supernatural that we can't explain with natural powers, something that happens naturally in this world, something, it's like a wonder. We can't explain it, right? That's what a miracle is. And how many of us know that we ourselves are very, very capable of miracles? Of doing things with the power of God that can't be explained? And how many of us know that a lot of times we feel like we're not ready because that's too much of a weight? Like, we're really, really good at putting pressure on ourselves. Really, really good at it. But I think sometimes we put so much pressure on ourselves that we don't realize the thing that we have inside of us, who is actually for? Huh. I'll ask a question inside of a question right here, okay? Who do you think Jesus turning water into wine was for? Who do you think it was for? Who was that miracle for? Go ahead, answer. I can't hear you, but I'm imagining you answering right now. Who is it for? Could it be for the people at the party? Could it be for the master of the feast? Could it be for his mama? Truth is, when we do the things that we do for God, we have absolutely no idea who this thing is for. Like the words that are coming out my mouth, I have no idea who this is for, who it's going to touch, whose life is it going to change. So how dare you put unnecessary pressure on yourself for something that you are not in control of? Huh. When the water was turned into wine, everyone at the party got to partake. This is Jesus' first miracle. And what if I were to tell you that this miracle was for him and his disciples? What if I were to tell you that him turning water into wine had nothing to do with the party, had nothing to do with the wedding, had nothing to do with satisfying all of these people? What if I were to tell you that this miracle was for him? This miracle was for his disciples. This miracle was for him because he had to show himself what he was made of. He had to show himself what he could do. Like, keep in mind, Jesus is not even 2 weeks out of going into the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights. Weary, tired, hungry. He doesn't exactly know what he's capable of just yet. But his mama did. In the text, it says that after everybody had their wine, it says now the disciples believed. Question for you. Do you know what it's like to follow someone that you don't believe in? Do you know what it's like to follow something that you don't believe in? Just because these disciples started following Jesus does not automatically mean that they believed in who he was. I believe that when the text says something, it says it for a reason. In verse 11, it said that this is the beginning of Jesus's of his miracles. This was the thing that manifested his glory and had his disciples believe in him. There is a manifestation of glory on your life that's not going to come out until you start doing the things that you said you're going to do. Until you start believing in yourself the way that Mary believed in Jesus. Until you start moving in that direction that you dream about every night before you go to sleep. And it says the disciples believed him. Like, this is here for a reason. We don't just believe in people just because they're nice, just because they're cool. We believe in people. We believe in things because we're drawn to them. This miracle wasn't for the party. This miracle was for the foundation of Jesus' ministry, for him and his disciples. And we just got a front row seat into the foundation of Jesus' ministry. You know what it's like to be on the ground floor of something that you believe in? It's because of this wedding, this water, this wine, that Jesus' ministry did so many great things over the next 3 years. This was the push that he needed. Now, anybody who knows me knows that, ooh, my heart is in music, in the arts, all day, all night. I'll probably be 70, 80 years old just thinking of words to rhyme, thinking about poetry, thinking about music notes, thinking about all that kind of stuff, right? That's always been my passion. And I remember I would write music every single day as a teenager, but I had never performed it in front of a group of people at all. So one day, ooh, he's gonna hate when I tell this story. One day, my brother comes to me and he says, hey, there's a showcase downtown at the Velvet Underground that I want you to perform at. As soon as he said, I want you to perform, my whole body just went, I don't want to do this. I do not want to do this. But instead of arguing with him, because I wasn't going to get nowhere, I was just like, oh, okay, I'll do it. So like for the next week, I'm in my room, Like, I can't even practice. My mind is just all over the place, right? And I get so overwhelmed with me being pushed on stage, because at this point, I ain't with it. I get so overwhelmed with it that I get this stupid idea. I says, you know what? If I leave my music at home, then I won't have to perform. Have you ever self-sabotaged something because you thought you weren't ready for it yet? Oh, God, yo. All right, so my brother, he come pick me up. And we're on our way downtown. My music is at the house. I left it there out of terror, out of fear. I was more afraid of getting on stage than I was of my brother getting upset. That's a lot of fear. It's a lot. So we get there, we get downtown, and we go to the DJ. He said, hey, where's your music? Here, my dumb behind, I do this. Oh man, I think I left my music at the house. My brother looked at me like he was about to shoot me in the face. And he didn't say nothing. He just looked at me. Like he looked through my soul. He's like, I know what you're doing and I'm not gonna let you do it. So this dude, he says, stay right here. He leaves, he goes back to the house. We live about 45 minutes away from the Velvet Underground. This is off of Peachtree Street. He goes back to the house, grabs my CD, and he comes back. At this time, I'm looking at the showcase. People getting up there, they performing, and I'm like, man, yeah, y'all hurry up. Maybe like when he get back, like the showcase will be over and then it'll be all over and I ain't gotta do this no more. And it's like the second to last person gets up there and he comes walking right back through the door. And all that fear, all that terror comes right back onto my body. And he gives the music to the DJ and he comes to me and he says, you going up next. You are going up next. At this point, I'm stuck. I can't get out of it. I can't run away. He might ride home. And I get on stage and the music starts. And all of a sudden, I feel this rush come over my body. I still don't remember what happened. All I remember is getting off stage and everyone being like, oh man, that was amazing. And people being like, man, that really inspired me. And people like, man, I gotta go back and write some more of my stuff too. That's all I remember. We leave the Velvet Underground. Oh, and my brother, he's still pissed. He is upset. But we're riding home and I still have this wave all over my body. And I'm realizing that was the push that I needed. There's no telling how long I would have waited until I was ready to jump on a stage. And think about it, like how much sense does it make that we have to be pushed into doing something that we love, into doing something that we're called to do, into doing something that we're purposed to do? Be very, very thankful for getting the push that you needed. Because if you've never gotten it, you got it today. Father God, we thank you. In the name of Jesus, we thank you for giving us the push that we needed. For pushing us out of our comfort zone, for pushing us out of the background, for pushing us out of this comfort of the familiar in our lives. Thank you for pushing us into the unknown, pushing us into this new light, pushing us into this new wave, this new way of serving you, of serving our purpose, of being servants to our own identities. Father God, thank you for showing us the things that Jesus does for our sake. Thank you for showing us the things that Jesus does for the sake of the world that you so love, that you gave him to us. Give us courage and replenish and refill our courage every single day so that we may go out there and push forward with this push that we needed. We love you. We honor you. We need you. We cherish you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Woo! First start. Man. We love you. God loves you so much more. Go out there and be dope. What would Jesus do? Hey, what's up, y'all? So glad and thank you for joining us here at Fresh Start Church. Now, with it being our mission to make Jesus famous in your life, we have three calls for you. The first, if you do not know Jesus as your Lord and Savior and you would like a relationship with Jesus, text that number. We can definitely help you there. Second call, if you do have a relationship with Jesus and he is your Lord and Savior, but you would like a better relationship with him, text that number. We got you. We can definitely help you there. And three, if you do not have a church home, there is nothing fresher than Fresh Start. We will get you into your Fresh Start, and we would love, love, love to have you. So join the crew. That is all three calls. If you want to be saved, if you want a better relationship, or if you want a church home, text that number. Also, the given options are in the descriptions. Hey, we love you, but God loves you so much more. Go in peace, and may the peace of God be with you.